Alright, so I was sitting in my room reading Fullmetal Alchemist, because that's what I do now apparently, wondering how I was going to start this video, and then boom! Literally a couple of chapters past where I stopped last video, began the single best action or plot sequence in the entire story up until now. It was freaking nuts! Like, as I said, I'm a big Dragon Ball fan and I'm reading this for the very first time, but there's a fight scene in this that's impressed me more than any fight I've seen in a long time. I have been enraptured by the dialogue and the twists and turns this thing has presented me. So let's not waste any time and get into it because it's so damn amazing. This is my continuation of Fullmetal Alchemist. Deception, espionage, thrilling action, like way too much fire. More fire than I'm comfortable with personally. And I'm not kidding when I say that this manga just went from great to incredible in the span of 3 chapters, and I cannot express just how much I lost my mind while reading this section. So let's try to figure out how they achieved this and why it works so damn well. And to kick it off, I am of course going to be talking about the framing of Lieutenant Maria Ross and the incident at lab number 3. To kick off this trek through peak fiction valley, Lieutenant Maria Ross, everyone's favorite subordinate of Colonel Mustang with a pistol, gets framed for the murder of Hughes. Now, at no point did I think that she was actually guilty or to blame. The story is written such that you're meant to sympathize with her, which makes what happens later oh so much more spicy. Arakawa, you're one sadistic woman that has a weird obsession with cows, but that's okay because you write incredible stories. But honestly, a lot of that deception here in this section is quite thinly veiled. However, with that said, it did cause me to become all the more anxious, so that's a good thing. With Ross being wrongfully framed, Edward and Al finding out about this last minute, and Barry looking to spring her from the prison, this was clearly all building to something significant, and boy, oh boy, was it ever.
Maria Ross, Dana.
Nani?
Okay, I know, right? This is amazing. This is nuts and freaked me the hell out upon first discovering what was left of the supposed Lieutenant Maria Ross. I was like, okay, story, that was pretty cool. But little did I know that the real stuff was just around the corner. Naturally, again, I didn't think that Mustang had this in him. He had been so dedicated to figuring out who unalived Hughes that there'd be no way that he'd be willing to, without hesitation, overreact to an escaping convict like this. No chance, particularly when it comes to Ross, especially given what we know about her situation, which you might see as a negative in the story. Should I have thought this was genuine? I don't really know, but I honestly don't think it matters because, once again, this all just made me lean in that much more as a reader. Something big was going down and we weren't being told about it. Now that said, when the dental records came up as a match, I did have a brief moment of pause to second guess myself, but you know what, I said no way. No way Mustang did that, they had to figure out some way around that. And the fallout of this after is handled remarkably well. From the action to the prior chapter to this one, the framing of events and tone of the material is far much more subdued and sad, as Ed and Al go to visit Hughes' family to explain themselves and to, well, apologize. There's an interesting lack of text or dialogue, instead allowing us to just exist in these moments with these characters. It's some of my favorite panel work by Arakawa, in all honesty. And I think that's saying something, given what she's done so far. Much the same way Ghibli knows how to use silence in their productions to evoke certain feelings from their audiences, Arakawa in this chapter knew how to strip back her stories such that the dialogue doesn't get in the way of these compositions she's constructed. It's fantastic and it only gets better from here. This is where things really start to get crazy and all the pieces we've seen not quite make sense start to make more sense and come together. Well, okay, not exactly. There's still some confusion when Armstrong randomly attacks Edward's arm out of nowhere and then drags him back to his hometown for, quote, repairs, wink wink, and then you get Mustang chatting on the phone to his girlfriend, wink wink. And from this point on, when the attack on Barry the Chopper using his old body occurs in the apartment that they were hiding out in, I honestly don't think I was prepared for what ultimately happened afterwards. As I mentioned in my last video, this seems to be a story that has its focus squarely on the characters and their respective stories. And as a result, the story itself has been spectacular, but there hasn't been as much emphasis on fighting as I would have come to expect from certain shonen stories. Even with the more emotional and subversive ones like Hunter x Hunter, that series' first arc was entirely built around shonen-style combat and competition, whereas Fullmetal Alchemist has been extremely restrained and measured in its approach, I think, regarding fighting. Well, that is up until now, because from this initial fight spawns the single best and most exciting sequences of fights I've seen in years as a reviewer, and I mean that. So again, just for context, my mindset going into this was that I expected something was up with Mustang and that Ross had to be somewhere, she couldn't be dead. But I had no idea how Barry the Chopper and his crew hiding out in the apartment fitted into this equation. And just as I'm thinking that, Lanfan senses 20 souls encroaching on their location. Now, that's a super handy dandy ability, and as soon as Mustang rallies his forces for support, Lanfan just pieces out and rushes towards those 20 souls. But first of all, can we just appreciate Mustang's subversion here? All those secret conversations were all set up for this ambush of an ambush, to leverage this occasion to bring him closer to the answers that he's looking for. The truth within the truth, if you will, or whatever that Marco guy said. Havok and Hawkeye pretty much go all guns blazing trying to make a difference, and that's when something unaccounted for goes wrong. Oh my god! Time to deal with this now, and so bullets don't seem to work. Not great, given that you're the bullet girl. Okay, think about things. And it's around here I remembered what Lanfan said earlier, right before she dashed away. She sensed 20 souls, but then found envy. They have all these lives trapped inside of them, or at least that's my impression right now, that's my theory. Maybe greed never cared about dying because he had so many souls inside of him already. He had an overabundance of them, you could say. I mean, that tracks with the greed moniker, right? And gluttony, I can imagine, the same is true for him, given how many times he's been shot and laughed it off like it was nothing. But hey, this girl seems to be doing a number on Envy, successfully one-upping Envy time and again, but not before shooting a flare to alert Mustang to their location. Hopefully, he can get there in time to save Hawkeye from gluttony. And this is just the beginning, guys. Can we talk about this not even being the good bit yet? Okay, I have to chill. Breathe, Mark. Whew. You're a professional. Get it together. This is amazing! Okay, everyone follows the body of Barry the Chopper back to Laboratory 3 as it retreats back to base. And this is where stuff goes down. My God, does it go down. So the first thing that blew my eyebrows off was the girlfriend Havok has been talking about lightheartedly over the course of these last few chapters. It's lust! And she's ready to throw hands or nails or whatever the hell she's doing, but whatever it is, it's scary and also kind of hot, but really scary primarily. And guys, this section is like revelation after revelation. I know I sound like I'm freaking out, but that's really the energy of these chapters. For a story that's been holding its cards super close to its chest since the beginning, only filtering the info out slowly across many chapters, seeing this flood of information was insane. Like Lust demonstrating that her core is the Philosopher's Stone and it's how they were created. Like, I don't even know what that means. Mustang and Havok versus Lust, I guess. She's been present the entire series, but now she's taking center stage. It's time to face Lust. This is top tier shonen shenanigans if ever I did see it, in the best of ways. My God, the beauty of this sequence is chef's kiss. I just have to gush for a few seconds, all right, because I found it that exciting. And one of the reasons it's great is primarily due to the power system of the world in question. You can look at any great shonen story, and 9 times out of 10, their best fights are the ones that can exist only within their established world. Well, once you remove character, at least. Naruto, Dragon Ball, One Piece, they all have amazing fights, and most of these great fights depend on the various systems that they have in place, whether they are simple or complicated, to give the altercation its own sense of dramatics and flair. And Fullmetal Alchemist in this one is no different. It's been established that Mustang, while powerful, seems to need a few things in place in order to be effective, or so we were led to believe at this point. He circumvents transmutation circles thanks to the gloves that he wears, and naturally, if the area has too much rain, the fire that he uses won't work. These are his limitations, and any Dragon Ball fan will tell you that once you add limitations to a technique, the tension rises. And good old Ron the Roy Mustang is no different here. Lust is in the position of power and overwhelming each of them, and it's from here she makes a calculated decision. She floods the room in water and retreats further into the building. As readers and viewers, we can cast our minds back to earlier in the story where the rain prevented Mustang from using his abilities in the first place, and thus we assume this case is identical to that one. But we and she were wrong. And this is where Arakawa writes a simple solution that makes total sense in her story. Mustang uses alchemy to remove the flammable gas from the liquid beneath him. That is genius, and not only that, turns the room she's hiding within into a bomb. Look, that was awesome. And Mustang says things like, oh yeah, she's totally cooked, I can feel the fat in the air landing on my lips. I mean, I gotta be real, I didn't need to hear that, but it's a neat little detail. But you know what else is a neat little detail? That. Not good for the heroes, but it was pretty cool. And when she said, I don't like being broken up with, I just know Arakawa was having all sorts of fun when she was writing this one. But the most hardcore part is when Mustang, with his bare hands, rips the Philosopher's Stone out of her chest in an effort to stop her and heal havoc. But she just begins to regenerate around the stone itself and his hand. Oh my god, that looks so creepy in the manga, and it made me wonder, does this mean that they are the stone? That every stone that was created is just another one of the homunculi? Also, I just noticed that if Lust Stone is there in her chest, and that's her tattoo, then that means that the tattoo's placement is directly correlated to the position of the stone itself within the host, which means Bradley's is in his eye and Gluttony's is in his tongue. Whatever the case, it's a crazy set of circumstances, and it's so fun to watch and speculate on. And while things go from bad to worse in this fight against Lust, Mr. I'm the secret evil king of the world Bradley shows up alone to intervene. At this point, I was curled up into a ball, feverishly flipping from page to page. I needed to know how this fight was going to end. And with the spooky disembodied voice of Pride, the only other homunculi unaccounted for us, calling both Envy and Gluttony back to base, it's safe to say that with Havoc unconscious and Mustang on the verge of death, now mortally wounded, things aren't looking good, guys.
Havoc, Shoei, 返事をしろ!
So Lust walks away from Mustang, leaving him to bleed out, instead choosing to confront Alphonse Elric. And while this could be considered the downbeat of the segment, there's a lot of narrative resonance to it, I think. A big motivating factor for Al moving forward is to ensure that no one has to pay for his mistakes or lack of ability again. And when you think about it, he's every bit as capable as his older brother. He just has the wrong mindset about it. In fact, every chance Edward gets, he points out just how much better his little brother is than him, whether it be fighting or alchemy or whatever. Fullmetal Alchemist as a title could very easily be talking about Al and not Edward Elric. In every way that matters, Al can be viewed as the main character if you want to. And in this scene, he shows a level of grit and tenacity that really made me respect him all the more as a character.
よくいった! Alphonse Elric!
Don't lose your way!
Oh my god, okay. Ooh, when this happened, I'm not kidding when I say I literally shouted, holy f**k, and jumped off my chair. This dude, Ronnie Boy Mustang, cauterized his own wound, etched a transmutation circle onto his own fist, and used Havoc's lighter as an ignition point. He's an absolute animal, and to boot, he actually kills Lust. Can we talk about him actually being the first person to kill one of the homunculi? I thought this was impossible. This is the most amazing fight scene, and I just have chills talking about it.
Full Metal Alchemist.
Switching gears now, we have Edward's side of the story to talk about and analyze. If you remember, he was dragged away before all this epic stuff went down, and while he does get dragged off to the middle of the desert to see a not dead Maria Ross, oh hey, look, yeah, she's pretty alive. And some ruins. I gotta say, the best part of this section reveals even more than what Alan Mustang got up to with Miss Lust Combust. For on his way to visit his mom's grave in his hometown, he runs into a familiar face.
Oh my god!
Yep, that's right, it's Pipe Man, or at least he looks like the leader of the homunculi, I guess. I mean, he's got the same beard and stuff. But with that said, and jokes aside, I actually loved this sequence in the manga. There's this super interesting conversation between Hohenheim and Edward that takes place right before his mother's and his wife's grave. Hohenheim draws attention to his burned down home, asking Ed, why did he do that? And Edward gives his typical answer, so that he can't look back, that it's a symbol of his resolve, his conviction in his overall goal we are all too aware of. And to that, his father disagrees, saying that it looks as though, to him, that Ed's hiding his mistakes so that he doesn't have to confront them. I personally don't know how to feel about this. Ed proves this thinking was wrong almost right away later in the story, but then again, I don't know if he'd have dug up that body in the backyard had he not felt his father could have been onto something here. But ignoring that for just a second, I do think it's interesting that he, Hohenheim, levels that criticism at Edward, his son. And my working theory right now is that it could very well be Hohenheim projecting. Think about it. At this moment in time, we have no clue as to why he's been gone for all these years. And then we see a scene like this. Earlier in the story, Hohenheim reveals that Ed is a lot like him, and to that I think what he means is that he's similar physically, yes, but also similar in his ability to get things done, his conviction, and from that moment he moves to take the only photo that exists of Trisha, his wife, himself and his two kids that exists right before leaving. However, not before saying that something terrible is coming and that Pinako should leave this country. Okay, so obviously, I'm excited for the implications of that last line, but I'd also like to further analyze what just happened here because the aftermath is sort of incredible. To confront what his dad just said, Edward, like I said, digs up the supposed body of his mother and discovers that not the bones nor the hair match his mother in the slightest. And through this discovery, it's revealed to Edward that he may be closer to helping his brother regain his body than he might think, and the connection made here is memory. The analysis and questions Ed posits to the group upon his return are unreal, proving that Al is the real Al because he has memories that he, Edward, couldn't possibly know about, and says that Al's new memories, the ones made after the incident, must be being stored in his body somewhere. That there's a connection between the body and soul, and that connection is the spirit. Al needs a physical body to house his thoughts and memories, and so that's his theory, that it must exist somewhere. And I think it's an awesome theory because it correlates perfectly with what Barry the Chopper's body confirmed for us earlier in the story. What was once so random now acts as a clever piece of foreshadowing of this very thread that I never anticipated. Al paid the toll to pass through the portal of truth, whatever that means, and so it begs the question, what's the truth that lies within the truth? They're using the word truth as like a noun in this instance, like it's referring to a particular thing, like a person or something, or an entity. Now, I've no earthly idea what's going on, but I do have another theory, so buckle up. I'm calling it here that Hohenheim is the leader of the homunculi, but even further beyond that, there's a moment he shares with Pinako where he alludes to not appearing to age. This is curious and got me thinking. Perhaps he doesn't seem to age for the same reasons the lifespan of all the homunculi and villains seem to be extended, and maybe he has the same goal Ed had to save his wife's life. Like I mentioned before, he seems to see a lot of himself in Edward, and if there's one thing that's for certain about Edward, is that he's got some impossibly strong convictions. Convictions that have led him to do some horrible things both to others inadvertently and to himself carelessly. And perhaps Hohenheim is of a similar mindset and capability. Perhaps his wife Trisha was sick and told him that she would hang on until he found a way to extend someone's life beyond natural means. This would then make sense of what Trisha said to Panico before she died, and it would explain why Hohenheim is so nonchalant about the time he missed with his kids and his wife. 10 years is an incredibly long period of time to go without seeking or making contact with them whatsoever, and given that he took the only photograph of them together, it implied, at least to me, some sort of emotional connection or fondness at the very least. And so, in my mind, taking the photo and choosing not to see them for 10 years, that doesn't really seem to correlate or work together in my mind. Unless time doesn't matter to him. Because once he finds the answer to immortality, to his wife's death, time, it won't matter. It's infinite. And if this is true and is his goal, then that positions Edward as the perfect polar thematic opposite to his father, stopping the ideology he once so feverishly sought to bring into this world in the past, but through his experiences learned the truth within the truth, in the process coming to appreciate that life is so special and as special as it is because it ends eventually, and that we should enjoy what we have while we have it. To prove this, Ed will have to stop his own father from trying to resurrect his own mother and to solve for immortality. But that's just a theory. And all right, so we have a better idea of what's going on now. Ed and Al are back together, thankfully. They're on the same page. Brilliant. They're determined to shoulder all of this without getting anyone else hurt. And what's more, they have a plan. This is a great plan. It might have a million different ways it can fail, might not get them what they want, and might also unalive them both, but it's a great plan nevertheless, using themselves as bait to lure in the homunculi to rescue their supposedly valuable selves. This is a very clever and ballsy move by Edward, and I honestly love it. It's so exciting to watch too, particularly when Gluttony and, oh, I forgot to mention, yeah, Glut and Envy got Marco before Breda and Mustang did to help Havoc, and he can't walk, it's sad, whatever. But as I was saying, this is a great plan, simply because this time we have a backup and I'm not talking about Mustang. I've thought for a long time that Lanfan and the folks from Xing have had a fascinating ability to sense what makes the homunculi part of what they are, what gives them away, that they are a cluster of souls engulfed inside one entity. It's a spooky fact, but were it to be true, it's kind of a remarkably handy trait for them to possess. And this ability they have, it works. They get their hands on who they're after, but as it happens, I was wrong. Not every homunculi is built the same. Wrath, apparently, he's built different. He passes as human. Not just to the broader military, not just to Edward and Al, but to Lanfan and Lin also, which is crazy because it leads to this. He slices Lanfan. No. And okay, this is a weird one. Not because Lanfan gets slashed, although that is certainly less than optimal for her, but you know, that's not what I'm talking about here. You see, in the anime, things progress as normal from this scene henceforth. The encounter continues and we switch perspectives to another altercation. However, in the manga, we get something entirely different. We get a short but illuminating scene with Hohenheim on a train that's taken over by bandits. And in this scene, he gets shot like a dozen times to no effect. He even goes as far afterwards to refer to himself as a monster. Now, I'm not a doctor, but I don't think normal human beings are able to do that. And so it further strengthens my case that he's either modified or not at all human anymore. Either way, I think it's a really strange choice for Brotherhood, the anime, to not adapt that, because on its face, it's a rather revealing and seemingly important scene, but oh well. Let's go back to the slicey slice. This is a surprisingly dramatic and strategic fight, and I didn't expect that at all. Lanfan is down and her only defense now resides in Ling, the person she's been tasked to protect, a character that up until now has acted like a freeloading spoiled prince. He's demonstrated some righteousness, but we've seen very little of him in serious action, predominantly leaning on a more comedic angle for a character. Until now. Immediately, he dashes to the aid of his subordinate, picking her up and confronting Wrath head-on, otherwise known as King Bradley, aka the scariest character in this story. And I think it's that aspect and our limited expectations of Ling that creates this wonder when Ling actually finds success. He employs strategy by consistently moving into his blind spot created by the eye patch and demonstrates a terrific level of combat ability. And even when cornered, he's always thinking about his next move. It's remarkable, and he even finds time to call out Bradley for being a fake king, adding a thematic element to it, that a king is for the people, not the other way around. And with that, throws a flash grenade to blind both Gluttony and Wrath, but one problem. That is freaking cool, man. I love that this story doesn't just have fights for the sake of fighting, and within these confrontations has actual strategy. Ling is wily and very game here, achieving all of this with his limited movement. While other stories would rely on signature techniques time and time again, the combat in this story feels once again very grounded, and it's totally in keeping with the tone of the story at hand here. A world filled with so much magic and wonder, but torn apart by the bitter reality of it all. Ling doesn't use magic or secret powers to overcome Wrath, but instead takes advantage of all the same traits that are apparent to us at home. Other stories that rely on names techniques certainly have their place, but there's just something so satisfyingly unique and appropriate about this story's approach. It gives it a really fresh identity, I think. And on the flip side, there's another fight that's taking place that we return to, and unsurprisingly, this one, to add variety, focuses less on the combat aspect and more on the words being exchanged here. This, by design, isn't so much a fight, but more so Edward buying as much time as he can. However, when Scar confronted Ed and Al with the ethical quagmire that was the state they left Nina following Show Tucker's horrid affair, it really elevated the reality of this story once again. Nina wasn't a throwaway character that existed in an early chapter we're allowed to forget about like Ed and Al wanted. She wasn't some NPC. She deserved moral consideration, and Edward just left her because he had no answers for her situation. Lonely, cold, and scared, they left her to just exist in pain. And Scar saw to that. Whether you agree or disagree with his approach, at least he did something. That really hit home for me. This would be like if one of the goons from the Red Ribbon Army that Goku killed was brought back to our attention by one of their family. It just retroactively changes the tone of the entire story in a brilliant way, I think. Ed does snap back at Scar concerning Winry's parents and how he took them out, but unfortunately, it was at the wrong time. This is honestly a terrific moment that complements the reality I touched on earlier. Something I've come to learn over the years as a reviewer is that every series emphasizes different aspects of their story to transport us from point A to point B. In Dragon Ball and One Piece, it's perseverance and tenacity the story leans on. In Hunter x Hunter, it's trauma. In Attack on Titan, it's this lust for revenge. But in Fullmetal Alchemist, it's humanity. It's flaw. It's the unsightly elements of the real world that make us feel uncomfortable when looking at them. It's the healing hands of a genuinely caring and kind person in Winry holding a deadly weapon with the intention of ending another's life. This story truly and wonderfully leverages the horrors of reality and melds them with the fantasy elements sprinkled throughout. It's hope versus despair, but I am forever grateful that Edward reminds her of who she is to him. It's such a beautiful moment nestled in the horror of the occasion, and I just don't think anything could be more in keeping with the tone Arakawa is trying to go for with this series. It's an outstanding scene. And what's more is, the other fight scene crosses over into this one. The following material is, and I kid you not, literally hype moment, after sad moment, after traumatizing moment, after more hype moments. I was so excited reading this week's material that, jeez, man. Seriously, the story goes nuts. So, Ling exploding from the sewer below throws a flash grenade at Gluttony, this time demolishing his upper body, and what's more is, he ties what's left of his body up in metal cables, meaning Gluttony's regeneration ability is now working against him. I think I love Ling. Yeah.
This is Future Mark here, and about loving Ling, I'm sorry, Past Mark, but you're in for a world of hurt later. But yeah, anyway, back to Past Mark.
And as it happened, Lanfan didn't off herself, which is great for her, and instead cut off her own arm and tied it to a dog, which is not great for her, but is a win for the dog, creating a fake blood trail for Wrath to follow. I love strategy like that. It's so fun. And by fun, I mean, you know, not in the body horror sort of way. So look, I've not spoken about this little girl looking for Edward at all that came from Xing. And look, I honestly don't have any feelings one way or the other about her. Of all the characters in this story, of which the vast majority are great, she's not really vibed with me since she got here. I mean, I know she's cute, I know she has some weird powers, but I gotta see some more from her. So far, she's kinda mid. With that said, Ling and Lanfan's side of the fight has been exceptionally strong, and thankfully, there's more where that comes from later. But not right now, because the fight's over and Winry's going back to Rust Valley.
Bye, Winry!
Pride and Wrath have a convo. I still have absolutely no earthly idea who Pride is. I mean, he's gotta be someone in the military, right? Or at least the government, or someone in power. I just know this is gonna be another one of those reveals that will completely take me off guard, and I'm anxiously waiting for it to happen. Happen already! Alright, so let's break it down for just a second. Envy and Marco have a conversation that reveals their ultimate goal, and when that goal was revealed to me, I was like, which is Irish for the following. Their war has been in the name of blazing a trail that carves out an enormous transmutation circle around massive population centers in the land. They plan on sacrificing everyone in the circle to create the ultimate philosopher's stone, one capable of God knows what, and that is such a comic book level threat. It's so massive that I can't even really get, like, that's such a, it's cool, but it's weird. It's weird in like a horrific kind of way, but it's very good. I like it. Furthermore, there's also this air of the youth of this generation writing the sins of the past. Gluttony's rampage is terrifying, and the design he boasts is terrific here. Mustang escapes by the skin of his teeth, leading Ed, Al, and Lin behind to fight. So, Envy shows up looking like a sort of horse thing that would make anyone scared of horses. Frankly, it's pretty dope though. Despite Envy showing up to take Gluttony home, they both get wrapped up into a fight with Ed, Al, and Lin, obviously. Lin takes Envy while Ed and Al try to tangle with Gluttony. I love all of these fights in this section of the story because they're all never really just as simple as we gotta destroy blah blah blah. This entire scene is made possible because Envy and Gluttony are under strict orders not to do any damage to Edward or Al, which creates really interesting encounters, I think. Like when Ed and Al were trying to bait them into the situation, or like right now, where something really cool happens. And before I get to that, I think something that's become apparent is that Ling is a fantastic character to watch fight and make sense of a given situation with. In a world filled with what are effectively magic wielders, he's just a dude with a sword. He just happens to be cunning with some pocket sand and deceptively capable. Dang. This is a really cool moment, by the way, but when Ed steps in front of Ling as he's about to be eaten by Gluttony, I gotta say, damn. Firstly, Arakawa knows exactly how to write characters that let their actions do the talking. And secondly, holy crap, I picked such a crazy spot to stop it last week. Like, ever since then, the fighting has been happening again and again and again, and it's been amazing. Like, let me paint you a picture. So, I'm enjoying myself, you know, reading the manga, having fun, and then Gluttony eats both Ed and Lin whole. Like, what the hell is happening? I'm sad. Al is sad. The whole thing is sad. Okay, it's not that sad. The journey inside of the belly of Gluttony is largely funny, if not slightly unsettling given there's no clear way out. But I think this is also a wonderful look at what makes Fullmetal Alchemist as great as it is in microcosm. Last week I touted a fantastic trait Edward has in the ability to keep pressing forward despite how impossible things at present seem. Lin even brings this up in this very section. They've shot guns in this space, opened bottomless holes in the floor, and have found that there doesn't seem to be any logical end to this place they've been trapped within. It very much, just like their overall goal in the story, seems impossible. But that doesn't stop Edward from earnestly trying, cracking wise, and remaining steadfast in his goal to move forward. He refuses to accept defeat, stubborn to the end. It's a wonderfully consistent character trait, I think. Envy reveals that they were behind the Ishvalan civil war, and thus the one behind Scar's killing intent motivation, and by proxy, the one that was indirectly responsible for Winry's parent death. Envy's real form, ready to fight, is grotesque and almost like something out of a Berserk comic. Easily the most impressive visual in the story so far, I think. Outside of that impending fight, Arakawa is setting up the pieces of this proverbial chessboard for later. The Alphonse storyline is taken to an admittedly very interesting direction when he demonstrates further growth by thinking on his feet, by being decisive, and actually convincing the impressionable Gluttony to bring him to his father, the supervillain behind all of this, the big bad that's AKA his dad. This should be interesting. And secondly, we haven't seen him in a short while, but Mustang is currently walking into the lion's den, so to speak, without knowing any better. It's extremely tense as he returns to the government HQ to see if he can find out or confirm that Wrath is in fact Wrath. Tense because we know he's going in to inspect the authenticity of this certain rumor, but additionally tense because we know that Bradley suspects him already from earlier in the story, and a general drags Mustang into a meeting room with all the higher-ups to tell this joke that he was using the test of water, and he has to do it to Bradley's face. I mean, it's a terrific scene, but I was on the edge of my seat all throughout this thing, but the long story short is he and Hawkeye are now essentially hostages of some sort. Envy versus Lin and Edward. So what do you do when you're stuck in an infinite void and need to kill the time? Try to kill each other! The fight here confronts Edward with a lot of difficult decisions though, puts him into a lot of compromising situations that Ling has to bail him out of until he can't any longer. But lying dazed on the floor, Ed recognizes a piece of rock next to him. Something we've all seen, but honestly, I didn't even really twig it. The piece that was missing from the ruin he saw back in the desert. That's a really cool catch. And furthermore, the revelation that Envy is composed of all the civilians that lived in that ghost town, Xerxes, and capital A-N-D, and was the one who started the civil war by killing that little kid, actually rocked my ever-loving world when I read it. Like, I have no idea why I never suspected that before. Shapeshifting and pretending to be different people and creatures has literally been Envy's entire MO and gimmick up until now. I feel like the biggest idiot for not guessing that earlier, but Arakawa, nice going. And this isn't even the wildest part. Edward opens up the same sort of portal he did before, and in the process, sees Al's body. And that might be the wildest scene I think the story has ever delivered for me. I got literal chills reading that. And I'm serious, it doesn't end there because my theory was ruined. Again, in the same video, I know, whatever, okay, it's a trend right now. Fullmetal Alchemist, you beat me, okay, whatever. Remember I said that Hohenheim was the big bad behind all of this? Well, it turns out he's not, apparently. It's the evil twin brother with no memory of who their father is. He just so happens to look like Hohenheim and just so happens to have comparable powers, I guess? Okay, I have honestly no idea what's going on anymore. Ed, Lin, and Envy come exploding out of Gluttony because that's cool. Not Hohenheim somehow heals Edward with some sort of divine magic and manifests another hand out of literally nowhere for Al. Like, where does he get the material? Why can he do all of this without so much as moving a muscle? And the way with which this dude talks, like, he talks as if he was a god talking to insects. Meanwhile, we get a short cutaway to Hohenheim for Arakawa to rub it into my wound right now because he's hiking up the mountains for some specific reason that I have no idea about. I mean, is he responsible for creating this person? I mean, maybe? Is he a person? I'm not even sure. I'm over 50 chapters deep and I am literally more confused now than when I first started. Like, Hohenheim in the mountains, not the one in the creepy underground bunker, but the one in the mountains, who knows that something massively dangerous is happening. I mean, he warned Pinako about this. I mean, like, that's that massive event where their town is trapped in some transmutation circle. I mean, so surely he must be in on it, right? Like, guys, I'm genuinely at a complete loss here. This might be the very first time a story has completely stumped me. My theory is out the window and I feel nothing but failure and sadness. Naturally, because all of that shock and, you know, him threatening Lin's life because he's, quote, unimportant, Ed jumps into action against Envy. I love the contrast, by the way, we see here between Ed with conviction in this scene versus Envy and Ed without conviction versus Envy. You know, in the depths of gluttony, he lost the will to fight and it was reflected in how he fared against the homunculi. But here, he seems to be less concerned with Envy and more so this dude who totally isn't his dad. And he fares much better. That is, until he turns off his transmutation powers. Seriously, the more I read, the more confused I'm becoming. And now he's turning Link into new greed. This is the single most insane chapter. My little heart can't take it. The only thing that would make this more insane would be if Scar were to show me. Hey, look, it's the little girl with the panda bear that I've neglected to mention properly up until now. But check this out, right? So Scar comes to the rescue, so he's sort of like the anti-hero meets the heroes to fight against some common enemy type of guy. And he even has one of those moments where the anti-hero is all like, maybe we aren't so different after all, in his head. He says that in his head. And then throws Al's head at a pipe to make the chimeras explode. Okay, I explained that poorly, but I don't care. I want to go back to reading more.
Wait, is that it?
Did Mark just leave the video without a conclusion?
What is the conclusion? What do we do?
What do we do then?